Ostende nobis, Domine, misericordiam tuam.
Et salutaris.
Domine, exaudi orationem meam.
Et adore sacrificat.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Oremus, exaudi nos, Domine Sancte, Pater omnipotens, Eterne Deus, et mitere digneris sanctum angelum tuum de celis, qui custodiat, foveat, protegiat, visitet, atque defendat omnes habitantes in octavitaculo, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Yeah.
Agnoscamus peccata nostra ut apti ad simus sacra misteria celebranda. Confiteor Deo omnipotenti et vobis fratres quia peccavi minis cogitatione vergo opere remissione. Mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. Ideo precor beatam Mariam semper virginem, omnes angelos et sanctos, et vos fratres orare pro me ad Dominum Deum nostrum. Misereator nostri omnipotens Deus, et dimissis peccatis nostris, producat nos ad vitam aeternam.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christe eleison.
Christe eleison.
Oremus. Deus, qui conspicis populum tuum nativitatis Dominicae festivitatem fideliter expectare, presta quesumus, ut valeamus ad tante salutis gaudia pervenire, et ea votis solemnibus a alacri semper laetitia celebrare, per Dominum nostrum, Iesum Christum, Filium Tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti, Deus per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Zephaniah. Shout for joy, O daughter Zion. Sing joyfully, O Israel. Be glad and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has removed the judgment against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You have no further misfortune to fear. On that day, it shall be said to Jerusalem, fear not, O Zion, be not discouraged. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty Savior. He will rejoice over you with gladness and renew you in his love. He will sing joyfully because of you, as one sings in festivals. Verbum Domini. Una lectura de la carta del apóstol San Pablo a los filipenses. Hermanos míos, alégrense siempre en el Señor. Se lo repito, alégrense. Que la benevolencia de ustedes sea conocida por todos. El Señor está cerca. No se inquieten por nada. Más bien, presenten en toda ocasión sus peticiones a Dios en la oración y la súplica, llenos de gratitud. Y que la paz de Dios, que sobrepasa toda inteligencia, custodie en sus corazones y sus pensamientos en Cristo Jesús. Verbum Domini.
Deo gracias.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Lucam.
Gloria a tibi, Domine.
The crowds asked John the Baptist, "What should we do?" He said to them in reply, "Whoever has two cloaks should share with the person who has none, and whoever has food should do likewise." Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they said to him, "Teacher, what should we do?" He answered them, "Stop collecting more than what is prescribed." Soldiers also asked him, "And what is it that we should do?" He told them, "Do not practice extortion. Do not falsely accuse anyone, and be satisfied with your wages." Now the people were filled with expectation, and all were asking in their hearts whether John might be the Christ. John answered them all, saying, "I am baptizing you with water, but one mightier than I is coming. I am not worthy to loosen the thongs of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." Exhorting them in many other ways, he preached good news to the people. Verbum Domini. Saturdays. And how's everyone? ¿Cómo están todos?
Just a couple of announcements. We want to say thank you for everyone who helped out with the Giving Tree and distributed the gifts yesterday and also got gifts for others. We thank Nancy Cody especially for organizing this for all of our neighbors in need.
Gracias a todos los que consiguieron un regalo para el árbol de regalos y también distribuyeron los regalos ayer. Y agradecemos especialmente a Nancy Cody por organizar este evento para nuestros vecinos necesitados.
Today we celebrate the feast day of Our Lady of Guadalupe. So there'll be mariachi in the park later this evening on the corner of Dr. James Parker Boulevard and Shrewsbury Avenue from 5 to 6:30 p.m. And then we'll have the procession at 6:30 p.m. here to the church, followed by mass here in the church once we get back. I don't know what time that'll be. So join us at 6:30. For the procession and the mass are required. And then finally, we'll have the traditional service of lessons and carols this Friday, December 17th, and again on Sunday, December 19th at 4 p.m.
Hoy es la fiesta de Nuestra Señora de Guadalupe. Entonces habrá mariachi en el parque en la esquina de Dr. James Parker Boulevard y Shrewsbury Avenue de 5 a 6 y media p.m. Y luego a las 6 y media procesaremos a San Antonio seguido de la misa aquí en la iglesia. Y se requieren mascarillas para la procesión y la misa. Y finalmente tendremos el servicio tradicional de lecciones y villancicos este viernes 17 de diciembre a las 7 p.m. y nuevamente el domingo 19 de diciembre a las 4 p.m.
Well, today's our third sermon in our sermon series, and today we'll look closer at the innkeepers of the nativity scene.
Hoy es nuestro tercer sermón de nuestra serie de sermones, y hoy veremos más de cerca a los posaderos del Belén.
You know, St. Luke tells us, you remember from the Gospel, that Jesus is wrapped in swaddling cloths and laid in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn.
San Lucas nos dice que Jesús está envuelto en pañales y acostado en un pesebre porque no había lugar para ellos en la posada.
And usually when we imagine this scene, we think of Joseph and Mary, you know, walking through the streets of Bethlehem, looking for a place to stay, and they find the local inn, and when they get there, the inn is full of people. There's no place for them to stay. So Jesus is born in a stable with animals because that's the last place they could find.
Por lo general, cuando imaginamos esta escena, pensamos en José y María, encontrando la posada local de Belén llena de gente. Entonces Jesús nace en un establo con animales, porque ese es el último lugar que José pudo encontrar.
But Luke's description, in light of the life in Bethlehem at that time, paints a different scene, a more beautiful scene, an amazing scene.
Pero la descripción de Lucas a la luz de la vida de Belén en ese momento pinta una escena diferente, una escena más hermosa una escena más hermosa.
Ordinarily, where would you find mangers in that time? Mangers would be found not out in a barn. That was, if you were really rich, you could afford to build a barn where you would separate it and put your animals out there in the barn and you'd put your manger in there where the animals would eat. But ordinarily, mangers would be right in your home.
Por lo general, los pesebres se encontraban en la casa. Solo una persona rica podría permitirse construir un establo separado para sus animales.
An ordinary house would have been built right next to a cave and would typically have two rooms with a flat roof.
Una casa ordinaria se habría construido al lado de una cueva en el tiempo de Jesús, en la época de Jesús. Y por lo general tendría dos habitaciones con techo plano.
The first room would have two divisions. When you walked in, you were walking right into the stable area, which was the cave part of your house that you built your house into. And there you would keep your animals at night. This area would have been lower than the rest of the house. It kind of would have been a little bit of a slope. Or you would build a second story for your house on top of this area. And this part of the house for that first room you walked into would have either the natural division from the slope, or you would put heavy timbers there to separate this part of the house where the animals were kept from the rest of the house, the main area of the house. This main area was the living room. This is where it was your dining room, your hangout room, your TV room, where you slept, ate, all of it. All of it took place right there in that part of the house, right next to the area where the animals lived. And in between these two areas, you would put your manger. It's where your manger would be for your larger animals. And it would either be built out of the wood, or you would dig directly into the stone of the ground and put the manger right there in the ground. This would allow the animals to do is, if the animals woke up in the middle of the night and they were a little hungry and they wanted a midnight snack, all they had to do was stand up for the bigger animals, lean over, and chow down. Instead of getting up, walking around through your bedroom, you know, tramping over everything to get, you know, to get their midnight snack. La primera habitación tenía dos divisiones. Cuando entras, entras al área del establo, donde se guardaban los animales por la noche. Esta área habría sido más baja que el resto de la casa o parcialmente separada con algunas vigas pesadas. Y junto a esta área estaba la sala de estar, donde su familia cocinaba, comía, dormía y vivía, todo en esta parte de la casa. Y entre estas dos áreas estaba el pesebre para sus animales, construido con madera o excavado directamente en el suelo. Esto permitió que los animales más grandes durante la noche, si ellos durante la noche tienen hambre, se pusieran de pie, se inclinaran y comieran directamente de estos pesebres desde su área de establos, en vez de caminar a través de su dormitorio. So the manger that Jesus was laid in was the manger within a home. Entonces el pesebre en el que Jesús fue acostado era el pesebre dentro de una casa. Well, why does Luke call it an inn then? Why does he say that there was no room for them because the inn was full? Well, he actually doesn't. You remember in the Gospels and the whole New Testament were originally written in Greek, so all the readings that we have are a translation, whether in English or in Spanish, of the original Greek. And in Greek, there's a very specific word for an inn, and Luke doesn't use that here. Instead, he uses the word for a guest room of a house, which is katalima in Greek. This would have been the traditional second room of a first century home, built on the side of the house or on top of it. Entonces, ¿por qué Lucas lo llama posada? Bueno, en realidad no lo hace, porque recuerda que la Biblia fue escrito en griego originalmente, y todas nuestras Biblias son traducciones del idioma original de la Biblia. Y hay una palabra específica en griego para posada, y Lucas no la usa aquí. En cambio, usa la palabra para la habitación de invitados de una casa, katalima en griego. Esta era la segunda habitación tradicional de una casa del siglo I, construida en el costado de la casa o encima de ella. Jesus was laid in a manger then, because there was no room in the guest room of that house. For two reasons, either because it was already occupied, there were already guests there that the owner of this house had staying there, or, and this is probably the case, there wasn't enough space there for Mary to give birth in that little guest room. Jesús fue acostado en un pesebre porque no había lugar en la habitación de invitados de esa casa, ya sea porque ya estaba ocupado por otra persona, o, y probablemente este es el caso, porque no había suficiente espacio ahí para que María diera a luz en este salón pequeño. And especially, traditionally, you think of it in light of the way women gave birth in the first century. When the time would come for a mother to give birth, what she would do is all of the men would be kicked out of the house first. The men had to leave. And then the village midwife and the other women of the town would be called to assist her in giving birth. She wouldn't be alone and left to her own in this extraordinary moment of her life. And then she would be taken down, usually into the stable area of the house, and there she would give birth with the help of the other women. And after giving birth, she would then return to the main area of the home. And that's where we find Mary when she lays Jesus in the manger that would have been found right there.
Tradicionalmente, cuando las mujeres daban a luz en el primer siglo, la madre bajaba al área estable de la casa y daba a luz con la ayuda de la partera del pueblo y otras mujeres del pueblo. Y después de dar a luz, la madre regresaba al área principal de la casa. Y ahí es donde encontramos a María cuando pone a Jesús en un pesebre, que estaría allá.
Isn't Luke's real portrait of Jesus' birth beautiful? Isn't it amazing to think of it in this way, to see the way it really was? Jesus was born in the heart of a family's home. And since he was in Joseph's hometown for the census that was being taken, it was probably the home of a relative or friend. Jesus was welcomed into the world with generous hospitality and the warmth and rejoicing of family and friends. ¿No es hermoso el retrato real de Lucas del nacimiento de Jesús? Jesús nació en el corazón de la casa de una familia. Y como estaba en la ciudad natal de José, probablemente era la casa de un pariente o un amigo. Jesús fue recibido en el mundo con generosa hospitalidad y con la calidez y el regocijo de familiares y amigos. We should really meditate upon the example of those who welcomed the Holy Family into their home this Christmas and ask ourselves, how do we welcome others into our homes? How do we welcome them here into the church? Are they greeted with friendliness and warmth? Do we serve them, even when it involves personal sacrifice or inconvenience? Debemos meditar en el ejemplo de quienes acogieron a la Sagrada Familia en su hogar esta Navidad y nos preguntamos, ¿cómo damos la bienvenida a otros en nuestros hogares? Y aquí en la iglesia, ¿son recibidos con amabilidad y calidez? ¿Les servimos incluso cuando se trata de sacrificios personales o inconvenientes? Each time we're called to practice generosity and hospitality towards others, let's see the Holy Family and those we're helping and serve them with joy. Cada vez que somos llamados a practicar la generosidad y la hospitalidad hacia los demás, veamos la Sagrada Familia en aquellos a quienes estamos ayudando y servamos con la alegría.
Thank you.
Orate fratres ut meum ac restrum sacrificium acceptabili fiat apud eum patrem omnipotentem. Devotiones nostre tibi domine quesumus ostia iugiter immoletor, quae et sacri perajat instituta Mysterii et salutare tuum nobis potenter operator per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen. Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sorsum corda.
Habemus ad Domino.
Gratias agamus Domino Deo nostro.
Dignum et justum est.
Vere dignum et justum est, ecum et salutare nos tibi semper et ubique gratias agere, Domine Sancte Pater Omnipotens Eterne Deus, per Christum Dominum Nostrum, qui primo adventu in humilitate carnis assumte, dispositiones antique munus implevit, nobisque salutis perpetue tramitem reservavit, ut cum secundo venerit in sue gloria maestatis, manifesto demum munere capiamus, quod vigilantes nunc audemus expectare promissum, et idio cum angelis et arcangelis, cum tronos, tronis et dominationibus, cumque omni militia celestis exercitus, imnum gloriae tuae canimus sine fini dicentes.
Oh.
Veri sanctus est Domine, fons omnis sanctitatis, ec ergo dona quesum spiritus tui rore sanctifica, ut nobis corpus et sanguis fiant Domini nostri Jesu Christi. Qui cum passioni voluntarii tradedetur, accepit panem et gratias agens fregit, deditque discipulis suis dicens, accipite et manducate ex hoc omnes, hoc est enim corpus meum, quod pro vobis tradetur. Simili modo postquam cenatum est, accipiens et calicem, iterem tibi gratias agens dedit discipulis suis dicens. Accipite et bibite ex eo omnes, ic est enem calix sanguinis mei, novi et eterni testamenti, qui pro vobis et pro multis effundetur in remissionem peccatorum, hoc facite in meam commemorationem. Mysterium fidei. Igitur mortis et resurrectionis eius, tibi Domine panem vitae et calicem salutis offerimus. Gratias agentis quia nos dignus abuisti, a stare coram te et tibi ministrare, et supplices deprecamur ut corporis et sanguinis Christi participes, a Spiritu Sancto congregemur in unum. Recordare Domine ecclesiae tuae toto orbe diffuse, ut eam in caritate perficias, una cum Papa nostro Francisco et Episcopo nostro Davido et universo clero, memento etiam fratrum nostrorum, qui in spe resurrectionis dormierunt, omniumque in tua miseratione defunctorum, et eos in lumen vultus tui admite. Omnium nostrum quesumus miserere, ut cum Beata Dei Genetrice Virgine Maria, Beato Joseph eus sponso, Beatis Apostolis et omnibus sanctis, qui tibi a saeculo placuerunt, eterne vitae meriamur esse consortes, et te laudemus et glorificemus, per filium tuum, Iesum Christum. Per ipsum et cum ipso et in ipso, est tibi Deo Patri omnipotenti, in unitate Spiritus Sancti, omnis honor et gloria per omnia saecula saeculorum. Amen. Precepti salutaribus moniti et divine institutioni formati, audemus dicere, Pater noster,
qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra, panem nostrum sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem, sed libera nos al malo.
Libera nos quaesimus Domine ab omnibus malis, da propitius pacem in diebus nostris, ut ope misericordiae tuae adiuti, et a peccato simus semper liberi, et ab omni perturbationi securi, expectantes beatum spem, et adventum salvatoris nostri Iesu Christi. Domine Iesu Christe, quid existi apostolis tuis, pacem relenco vobis, pacem meam do vobis, ne respicias peccata nostra, sed fidem ecclesiae tue, eamque secundum voluntatem tuam pacificare et coadunare degneris, qui vivis et regnas in saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et in spiritu tuo.
Ecce Agnus Dei, ecce qui toli peccata mundi, beati qui ad cenam agni vocati sunt. Domine, non sum dignus, ut intres sub tectum meum, sed tantum dic verbo et senabitur anima mea.
Oh, my Jesus.
Oremus. Tuam Domine clementiam imploramus, ut ec divina subsidia habitis expiatos, ad festa ventura nos preparant, per Christum Dominum nostrum. Dominus obiscum. Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
Deo gratias.
Oh, Philip the Monk.